ambassador to China is walking back his comments about Meng Wanzhou's extradition case, comments that prompted calls for his removal. This week, John McCallum had said the Huawei CFO had a good chance of avoiding extradition to the U.S. Now, as we said, he's saying something different. Quote, I regret, John McCallum writes, that my comments with respect to the legal proceedings of Ms. Meng have created confusion. I misspoke. These comments do not accurately represent my position on this issue. As Canada's ambassador to China, I play no role in assessing any arguments or making any determinations in the extradition process. But could those comments have already been heard by the U.S. government, and could they affect Canada's relationship with the U.S. earlier this afternoon prior to McCallum's latest statement? I spoke with a former U.S. diplomat. Here's that conversation. Susan Shirk is a former Deputy Assistant Secretary of State during the Clinton administration. She's currently a professor at the School of Global Policy and Strategy at the University of California, San Diego. Hi, Professor Shirk. Great to see you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
I want to get to the complexities of the West's relationship with China these days in a second, but first, Canada's ambassador to China recently made some controversial comments. He said Huawei's CFO Meng Wanzhou has a strong case and that extraditing her would amount to a, quote, unhappy outcome. What do you think of those comments?
Well, they're highly unusual for any ambassador. Ambassadors really deliver the messages of official policy and normally don't extemporize giving their own views, especially injecting himself into the middle of a legal matter. So I'd say it's highly unusual. But of course, President Trump's statements were also highly unusual.
Yeah, and I want to ask you about that, because Ambassador McCallum also referred to those, essentially saying that Canada found itself in the middle of a trade dispute between the U.S. and China, and pointing to those comments and sort of itemizing them in a list of things that would amount to a strong defense for Ms. Meng. What do you make of that?
Well, I think that was imprudent on his part, because it puts him solidly in the defense camp rather than taking an impartial stance, which is the stance the Canadian government has taken.
Do you think that that what he's saying, though, the content of it, especially where President Trump's comments are concerned, do you think there is some truth to the fact that those might be not even used in the defense, but for example, were just not amounted to political interference of some sort?
Well, I think President Trump made a big mistake in suggesting that the arrest of Meng Wanzhou is a card that could be played in the economic, the trade and investment dispute between the United States and China. And that seems to have emboldened China to act similarly by arresting Canadians in order to get their own card. On the other hand, the company itself, Huawei, I think has behaved in a very dignified manner. So we have the corporate side of this and the legal side of it is proceeding more or less normally. But the American government, the Trump administration in particular, and the Chinese government in Beijing, Xi Jinping, have both behaved in a very odd way, which is just makes for more complications, and I'm sure is extremely frustrating for Canadians who feel caught in between.
Can I ask you to expand on what you mean by Huawei behaving in a dignified manner? And I ask only because, I mean, the impression that we have is that there are certain ties between the company and the government in China, and that in some ways the government's reaction is a proxy for Huawei, though I take your point that the corporation itself hasn't made those types of comments.
Well, that is the big problem that Huawei faces, is that everyone assumes that they are just a proxy for the government in Beijing. I actually think that Huawei acts more independently than we realize. The problem is that in the Chinese system today, when the Chinese government makes a request of a private firm, it's very difficult for the private firm to resist. And even if they want to act independently. And that's what has tainted Huawei all around the world. Now, of course, this case has to do with a fraud case. It has to do with Iran sanctions. It really doesn't have anything to do with the national security risks of having Huawei equipment. But it's difficult for people to sort out all these different strands in a very complex situation. So Huawei, when I say that Huawei is behaving in a, well, you saw Chairman Ren Zhengfei came out and said that even when the Chinese government makes a request of Huawei, they don't necessarily or they won't comply with that request. The problem is that that type of commitment is not credible because the Chinese system has too powerful a state vis-a-vis the private sector.
I would imagine that for those of us watching from the outside, when we see, for example, the CFO of that company go through the extradition process as she is, and as a result, two Canadians get detained, it's very hard to separate the two entities.
Absolutely. And, Xi Jinping and the Chinese leadership just further increase the suspicion that Huawei and the Chinese government are much the same thing by arresting people who appear to be completely innocent of the charges and hold them as hostages. And that's why many of us signed this letter to Xi Jinping requesting that he release them. But the whole thing is very complex because nobody's sure that President Trump won't intervene in the case and turn what is a legal matter into a political matter again.
Do you think that, if Ms. Meng is extradited, and I mean the Department of Justice says they're going ahead with, seven more days to extradite her, do you anticipate more retaliation from China? And do you think those countries who have stepped up to support Canada and issued statements of support are vulnerable to that kind of retaliation as well?
Well, I think there's safety in numbers. And I think it's very important that countries stand together on telling the Chinese government that they can't make individuals pawns in some basically legal and commercial dispute, and maybe it's a diplomatic dispute as well with the United States and Canada. So that is really beyond the pale. It just exceeds international norms completely to use individuals as kind of pawns or hostages in this kind of dispute. So I think it's very useful, very important for other countries to support Canada here.
All right. Thank you so much, Professor Shirk. Really appreciate your time today.
Okay.